please welcome Emily Albright, Reagan Ondler, and Harper Ondler to the stage for a very special introduction.
Good afternoon, Kansas FFA. I am Emily, Karlie's older sister, and this is Reagan and Harper, our cousins. Growing up, Karlie was always known as my little sister, following me around and wanting to do everything that I was doing. While at the time, I did not always appreciate her, it was very special to grow up so close. We were in sports, 4-H, and FFA together. Whatever I did, she did too. She spent countless hours cheering me on, just waiting for her turn in the spotlight. As time went on, Karlie started creating her own path within the FFA. When Karlie decided she wanted to run for state office, she was all in from the beginning. Seeing her dedication to FFA this past year has been truly inspiring. She has made it her mission to get to know as many FFA members as possible and help them in any way that she could. From all the stories she has told us, I would say that she has done just that. After this year, it is safe to say that the tables have turned, and now I'm the one looking up to her, and I could not be prouder. Karlie has grown into a young woman with so much passion and drive to always do her best. I am truly honored to call her my little sister. She has a lot of fans in her corners, but two of the biggest are these two little girls right here. They look up to her not only for the qualities I have already mentioned, but also for her love and dedication to her family. We are honored to present to you my little sister
and our cousin
and your Kansas State FFA president, Karlie Albright.
Ready. And it's a great day to be alive. I know the sun's still shining when I close my eyes. There's some hard times in the neighborhood, but why can't every day be just this good?
And things were heating up for the most divisive political battle we've ever seen. Voters rallied to support the candidates that best represented their needs. It was filled with drama, suspense, and dedication by the candidates, and worst of all, the media outlets didn't cover it. Because it was my seventh grade student council elections. After the grueling process and completion of the votes, the results were in. And just like that, I was named the girl student council representative for the entire seventh grade. At the time, this was a pretty big deal for me because it was one of the first opportunities that I had to be a leader in my class. So come eighth grade year, I made the bold decision to run for middle school student council president. When they announced the candidates, I found out that I would be running against one other individual, whom we will call Ryan for the sake of the story. Similar to the previous year, these elections were filled with drama, suspense, and candidates' dedication. Throughout the weeks leading up to the elections, we would show our dedication by having conversations with our peers, seriously discussing what we would do to make a change in our school. I don't exactly remember my political sales pitch, but it was likely somewhere along the lines of, I will strengthen the school by building a sense of community, by improving relationships between students, teachers, and parents. Like any middle schooler wants to hear that. And Ryan's campaign pitch? As president, I promise to install a school swimming pool. Now that sounds like fun. When it came time for the elections, we each had to give a short speech as to why we should be elected. We poured every intention we had for the school into those speeches, which sounded very similar to our previous conversations with our peers. After we gave those speeches, our classmates made their votes. We waited in great anticipation to hear who the individuals were that would serve on the Royal Valley Middle School Student Council. And then it was time. They announced over the intercom, and for the office of Student Council President, Ryan Walsh. In that moment, a wave of frustration, anger, and disbelief washed over me. Seriously? I had honest conversations, yet how could my classmates elect a guy who promised something he could never fulfill? How are we supposed to pay for a swimming pool with a bake sale? As I continued to process all that had just happened, my peers informed me that, previous to the vote, Ryan told everyone not to vote for me because Karlie wins everything, and it's about time she lost. Every step that he took to get elected raised a fire within me because I didn't think he was doing it for the right reason. I don't really think about that day, May 3rd, 2017. Okay, maybe I do. And when I do, I wonder, did Ryan run for that position because he truly wanted to be a leader in our school? I doubt it. However, I can't say for sure. What I'm sure about is that I have learned a lot since then. There was no cheating in the elections. All the students voted and all the votes were counted. Ryan won fair and square. So why have I been angry at him all this time? We have instincts to be angry and upset when we lose or fall short of something that we strive for. We then blame that on the other individual because that is the easy thing to do. But we shouldn't be mad at the other individual for their success, and we shouldn't even necessarily be upset with ourselves as long as we tried our hardest. But what we must do is accept our defeat, acknowledge our shortcomings, and press onwards towards our own self-improvement. It's a challenge to grasp onto that concept that we haven't reached the peak of our potential, but that is what will eventually make us stand out. We each get to make the choice whether we want to focus our energy on something of the past that we can't change or whether we want to focus that energy on something of the future. There's a line in the song Biscuits by Casey Musgraves that says, "I've never gotten taller making someone else feel smaller." The grudge that I was holding wasn't making me feel taller. It only distracted and held me back from finding ways to serve others in another capacity. Every bitter thought, every ounce of annoyance inside me, all of that effort towards negativity, and for what? To prove what? That I'm a better leader? A better leader would be honorable enough to accept this defeat gracefully and not be spiteful of an outcome. A better leader would choose to put the past behind and actively be kind. A better leader would serve regardless of a title. If we fall short of something that we strive for, it is okay to be upset. In fact, these feelings are important in reminding us that we truly care about the situation. But we shouldn't be mad at the other individual for their success, and we shouldn't even necessarily be upset with ourselves as long as we tried our hardest. But what we must do is accept this defeat, acknowledge our shortcomings, and press on towards our self-improvement. We all get the chance in our lives of what situations and how we react to them. We get to make that choice whether we want to focus on something of the past that we can't change or whether we want to focus on something bigger than ourselves. One of the richest and most successful people in the world didn't have a one-and-done success story. When this individual was around the age of 15, he and his friend began building software that tracked data within traffic. They built up a computer, thought that they had it running effectively, showed it to their first possible client, and the result? A fail. But this young man truly enjoyed devoting time to building software, so he didn't let that failure stop him. Billionaire Bill Gates didn't start out with immediate money in his pocket. He and his friend Paul Allen accepted this defeat of their original project and figured out ways that they could move past it, creating what we all know as Microsoft. A billion-dollar company that made these men so rich started from a failure that they overcame. They got knocked down, even if it was by a piece of technology, with the ability to be angry with the situation. But they didn't hold a grudge or have pity for themselves. Bill Gates and Paul Allen failed at first, accepted those struggles, figured out ways that they could move past it, and ended up changing the face of technology. Think in your head if any of these situations have applied to your life. Someone else gets the parking spot that you were about to go for. Your blood begins to boil and you have the urge to scream in your car. When you stop and give them credit for being just a little bit quicker. Maybe you've helped a friend study for a test that ends up getting a better grade than you. You automatically feel bitter and angry towards your friend, and when you're trying to decide to tell them whether they owe it to you, you stop and congratulate them for successfully understanding the material. Maybe you've run for re-election for an officer position just to fall below the same individual as the previous year. The frustration is overwhelming, and all you want to do is cry, and then you stop and congratulate them, being excited to work together to make an impact in the future. Or maybe you stood on this stage this week and didn't receive the outcome that you hoped for. Your hard work feels unnoticed, you wonder why you weren't good enough, and you are discouraged. And then you stop and congratulate the successful individual, being proud of the hard work that allowed you to stand on this stage in the first place. All of these situations can leave us with a feeling of frustration, anger, and pity for ourselves, but we shouldn't let these moments of perceived failure define us. It's how we recover and move past these situations that should define us. As we go throughout different times in our FFA careers or other areas of our lives, we must remember that falling short of success creates the perfect time to practice having respect, even if it is losing the most important political battle we've ever seen. We should congratulate the Ryans out there out of the goodness of our hearts for the great work that they have done. We should accept our own losses and use those hardships to learn a lesson. Then we should analyze the areas that we can be better and create goals that will help us to further reach our full potential. Kansas FFA, it is not an easy journey, but in order to be our best, we must lose with grace, understand our flaws, and emerge into someone greater.
When those dreams you're dreaming come to you, when the work you put in is realized, let yourself feel the pride, but always stay humble and kind.
Karlie, our team had no idea just how lucky we were when you were chosen to lead our team and the entire Kansas FFA Association. You have somehow really impressive karaoke skills that seem to get us through all of our very tragic travels this year, and that pack of playing cards that you always have on us to keep us distracted. Over all the hundreds of peoples we met, the thousands of miles we've traveled, one thing is for sure, and that is that there's no one quite like you. You have a heart of gold, and you are the definition of a servant leader. Kansas FFA, your state president, Karlie Albright. Please join me in welcoming to the stage some of the people who have inspired and prepared Karlie for her year of service and the Kansas FFA members.
Emily, you are a large part of my initial involvement in FFA. Thank you for dragging me to your early morning parlaw practices and encouraging me to go to contests as a freshman. I admire your strength to keep going during the tough times, and I'm thankful to have you as a built-in best friend. Mom, thank you for developing a love for this organization and for supporting me every step of the way through my FFA journey. From editing my resumes to going and helping me practice for my interviews, I'm so thankful for every way that you do all that you can to help me succeed. You always have a listening ear and know the exact times to give the best advice. I am blessed to have your love and encouragement. Dad, thank you for constantly pushing me to get outside of my comfort zone and reminding me that the hard times only make me stronger. You are the best assistant at brainstorming speech ideas and have instilled in me a love for agriculture. Thank you for sharing with me your passion and knowledge and for constantly pushing me to be the best version of myself every day. Kansas FFA, please help me recognize my parents, Scott and Barbara Albright, who have already received their honorary state FFA degree. I would like to thank Mr. Holliday and Mr. Figge, who served as my district advisors during my time as a district officer. Thank you for your commitment to the Northeast District and all that you have done to make an impact while fulfilling these roles. Ms. Clark, thank you for seeing a leader in freshman Karlie that she did not see within herself. You are a very persistent individual, and I am thankful that you saw so much potential within me. Thank you for helping and picking me up during the tough times and for cheering me on in the happy ones. I truly would not be here without you, and I'm thankful that you have helped me find this path in my life. Kansas FFA, please welcome my advisor, Ms. Clark. Thank you to everyone at my high school and the members of the Royal Valley FFA chapter for being such loyal teammates and friends. You have made my time in school so special and full of great memories. Mr. Davis, thank you for all that you have done to help the Royal Valley FFA chapter. Thank you for your support in developing our program resources, as it is going to continue to make an impact on the future members of Royal Valley FFA, just like it has done so for me. Thank you again for all that you do for USD 337 and the Royal Valley FFA chapter. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my school superintendent, Mr. Davis.
Thank you for your continued investment in Karlie and in Kansas FFA. Members and guests, please join me in a final round of applause as these extraordinary individuals exit the stage. And it's a great day.